I'd like to introduce you to our first speaker, David Vincent, who is visiting us from the Open University. He's also a visiting professor from Keele University. He is the author of no less than 16 or 17 books now, author-editor? Author or editor of 16 or 17 books now, his most recent being Privacy, the History of, which has been referenced on earlier today, which I'd all highly recommend you to read. I'm delighted to say he's also a visiting fellow here with us at CRASSH and has been a fantastic contributor also to the Technology and Democracy Project. And that's not just today, that's been for other contributions as well.
Hey, thank you, and my thanks to John Norton and his colleagues for organising this really interesting programme of speakers. Since the late 1960s, the death of privacy has been regularly reported in much of the press, broadside as well as tabloid. It's achieved a kind of zombie status. This is privacy. Repeatedly killed, only to rise up again with an axe through its head. But in this paper, I want to suggest that it's not privacy, but rather the liberal state in relation to privacy, which, if not dead, is in some serious difficulty. Now, it's in the nature of the liberal state for there to be constant debate about the boundary between government and civil society. One of the several reasons why Orwell's 1984 should not be taken as a forecast of our current circumstances is that the surveillance systems it describes are embedded in a violent, totalitarian authority structure. What is forbidden on pain of torture and death in the novel is any reflection on the rules by which power is exercised. And in the democracy which began to take form during the communications revolution of the second quarter of the 19th century, the line between private and public was and remained as much a matter of culture and expectation as of formal legal controls. The fixed points of freedom and constraint were infrequently inscribed in law and were always open to further interpretation. Government was left with considerable latitude to extend their powers at times of unforeseeable threats to public order. Citizens continually explored ways of acting individually and collectively to assert their interests. What mattered above all was a level of consent about the role of government, and the capacity freely to discuss further reform in the face of continuing economic, social, and technological change. And it may be argued that the present difficulties of the liberal state reflect some seizing up of the process by which adjustment and negotiation takes place. It's a form of political sclerosis threatening a full coronary at any moment. Now, the hinge of this history is the first and the last official inquiry into privacy in Britain. The Younger Report of 1972 was based on a double exclusion. At the outset, it restricted its inquiry to the non-governmental sector. The current and potential behaviour of the state in the digital area was off limits, despite or perhaps because of the fact that as early as 1967, the journalist Chapman Pincher had revealed that the National Security Agency was collaborating with GCHQ in securing intercepts from American telephone corporations, a fact which we seem collectively to have forgotten about until Snowden. Then a distinction was drawn between categories of private communication. It wrote, "We have conceived of the right of privacy as having two main aspects. The first of these is freedom from intrusion upon oneself, one's home, family, and relationships. The second is privacy of information, that is, the right to determine for oneself how and to what extent information about oneself is communicated to others." Now, what became known as information privacy was subsequently translated into data protection legislation driven by a European-wide policy framework And Nora will answer all questions on that subject, as she is a serious expert. But intrusion upon oneself, one's home, family, and relationships was consigned to the informal sector. What the report described as the varied pressures, educational, cultural, and social, employed in a democratic society to persuade particular sections of the community to behave in an acceptable manner. Now, these exclusions were protested at the time and later, but both reflected long-standing approaches to the balance between the state and civil society. The first public outcry about government surveillance of private behaviour occurred in 1844, when the Home Office was accused of using the newly reformed post office to open the posts of political opponents at the behest of an overseas government. The response was the invention of the doctrine of declining to comment on matters of national security, which is still visible in the handling of the Snowden revelations. It was an evasion of debate, but at the same time, an affirmation of the value of public service. The notion of honourable secrecy implied that the private realm was best protected not by regulation, but rather by the character of politicians and civil servants charged with managing the necessary secrets of government. Their private values could guarantee public good. Through a combination of birth, education, and an abnegation of self-interest, those in power could be trusted to police the boundaries of the state. And on its own terms, honourable secrecy delivered both a relatively uncorrupt and a relatively efficient government machine, which for a century or more generated substantial public trust. But from the outset, the state struggled with a set of growing difficulties. The most obvious was scale. The continuing growth of government sucked in employees who were not gentlemen, and still worse, not men at all. The Official Secrets Acts of 1889 and 1911 were reluctant concessions to formal controls, albeit drawn as vaguely as possible, designed to discipline not the senior members of the machine, but the junior staff in possession of confidential information. Since then, expansion at all levels, particularly at the heart of the secret state, has compounded the difficulty. With approaching 10,000 staff in the combined ranks of GCHQ, MI5 and 6, 40,000 in the NSA, plus those working with security clearance in other parts of the machine or for defence contractors, there is diminishing certainty that any combination of culture and regulation will prevent recurrent breaches of security. A further difficulty was discourse. A consequence of the tradition of declining to discuss invasions of privacy was an inability to deny what the state was not doing. The biographer of the Home Secretary in 1844 depicted the ensuing media storm. It was like a match struck for a moment amid profound darkness, revealing to a startled crowd vague forms of terror of which they had never previously had a glimpse and about which they forthwith began to talk at random until a gigantic system of espionage had been conjured up, which no mere general assurance of its unreality could dispel. Substitute Snowden, and the description stands. Now as then, it was argued that there was a legal authority for the surveillance of private communication and that senior politicians were denouncing practices which they had themselves deployed in office. However, obscurity was and has remained a chosen mechanism for managing debate. As David Anderson observed, the controls under which we now live are incomprehensible to all but a tiny hand of initiates. And you remember David Feldman this morning stressing the importance of clarity in any effective legal process. The current Investigatory Powers Bill marks the first occasion since the modern secret state took form where draft legislation has been open to public debate. But once more, every effort is being made to leave the key boundaries between private and publicly accessible information as vague as possible. And unlike the associated reports by David Anderson and Russi, the 296 pages of legal drafting and explication avoid the subject of how society regards privacy as a value and as a possession. There is no common basis for negotiation, no shared language of debate. Incidentally, those who worry that MI5 has no respect for private life should be reassured. This advert appeared on my website as I was writing this paper. I don't exactly know why, but it's from MI5. It's from their recruitment process. You can't take your work home, it says. Therefore, your private space remains private. Now, that were true of university employment, my working life would have been so much easier. Younger's second exclusion also reflected a long-standing settlement that was no longer future-proof. The 19th century liberal state embodied an investment by government in what Younger termed the varied pressures of educational, cultural, and social employed in democratic society to persuade particular sections of society to behave properly. A combination of the churches, the Victorian family, and emerging collective institutions such as the professions and friendly societies were thought capable of ensuring appropriate private conduct without the need for direct state intervention. At most, government provided the legal framework for private institutions and dealt with outlying disciplinary issues. And it was a two-way process of trust. The state respected the capacity of the informal sector to encourage and enforce appropriate conduct. Civil society had confidence in government's ability to act with integrity and restraint. And you can see this in the treatment of income tax, which has been the matter of some discussion in the last fortnight. As you probably know, the income tax was introduced in 1842 on a temporary three-year basis by Peel. And it was required actually to fill in the gap caused by the introduction of the penny post in 1840, which had been much more expensive than expected. As Martin Daughton has shown, over the remainder of the century, and with much debate, a deal was struck. Income tax was accepted because it was intrinsically much fairer than indirect taxes. And under Gladstone and his successors, it was recognised that the exchequer was being efficiently controlled and put to appropriate uses. Governments were allowed to prepare their budgets in complete secrecy to avoid the danger that they would be lobbied by special interests. And for their part, taxpayers were permitted and indeed encouraged to use intermediaries such as the emerging profession of accountancy on the grounds that accountants, now listen to this, embodied standards of ethical conduct that aligned with the needs of the state. And the state as a financial entity ended at the shores of the British Isles. Now the state has lost control of its fiscal boundaries and is losing confidence in the capacity of accountancy sector to embody any values other than the private interests of wealthy taxpayers. And by the same measure, the enshrouded secrecy of the budget setting process here and in Brussels looks more like a cover for lobbying by interest groups than a defence against it. Now, Younger's distinction between the role of government and civil society and the defence of privacy was rendered obsolete by the technological changes that had caused the report to be written. In Britain, as in most of Europe, the institutions for promoting the realm of virtual privacy were all within the public sphere. The postal system, the new electronic technologies of the telegraph and the telephone were or became government monopolies. Of these systems, the post office played much the most important part in the lives of the majority of the population. The flow of correspondence didn't actually overtake the flow of telephone calls until the 1970s, the time that Younger was written. And it was a very labour-intensive institution. 1914, there were 225,000 postal workers. It was, in every modernising country, the post office constituted by far the largest non-military bureaucracy. And unlike the police force, whose members were generally regarded as corrupt and violent and or incompetent, these personnel, men delivering letters up and down the streets, in every community in the British Isles, were respected for their honesty and efficiency. It's so widely trusted that the post office was given control of the first working class bank, the post office bank, and in the 20th century became the pay station for the welfare state. In an era when most of the population had only occasional contact with official life, the post office was not only run by the state, but more than any other service made the modern state acceptable. I guess you can read this while this is going on. This is from Jonathan Franzen. I've just been reading this. It's on the states, a kind of encomium of the battered American post office, even in that country which so mistrusts central state services. It has a particular status. The emergence of new systems of digital communication coincided with neoliberal attacks on the size of the state, which had everywhere been inflated by the growth of the welfare systems. And faced with the scale of investment required by internet providers and the emergence of new business models, governments withdrew from the field, issuing licenses to private sector and then selling off the analog and paper-based communication systems, which had for so long been their responsibilities. Attempts were made to prevent the misuse of emerging private monopolies, but the locus of trust had now passed out of government. Where once the culture, delivery, and regulation of public service had been an integrated whole, now they were dispersed amongst a range of political and commercial bodies with no single focus of policy or responsibility. And whatever view is taken of the current row between the FBI and Apple over encryption, there must be some caution about vesting the definition and defense of privacy in the unaccountable hands of a company whose principal loyalty is to its sales and share price. Now, the freedom from intrusion upon oneself and so forth, described by Younger, embodied an explicit withdrawal by the state. It was part of the contract of liberal democracy that the government supplied the infrastructure of virtual interactions, but refrained from using the expanding networks to enhance their capacity to invade the intimate lives of individuals. Just as the threshold of the home could not be crossed by the police without a warrant, so the contents of correspondence, as also telegrams and phone calls, could not be intercepted without a legal authorization. The state came to believe that it could govern effectively and efficiently without inquiring into the thoughts and communications of its subjects. The 1832 Reform Act produced what Ian Hacking terms the avalanche of numbers, driven by the need to create a program of evidence-based legislation. But the work of the General Registry Office, the Board of Trade, Statistical Societies, was limited in its ambition. The decennial census only recorded names as a means of checking the accuracy of the enumerators. No further use was made of the domestic information, and in particular, no attempt was made to link this database to any other official or private archive. The inquiries into matters such as literacy or housing conditions were designed to construct the en moyenne, the average man, not, as Dickens protested, to expose personal secrets. And in the 20th century, in this country, national registration was only permitted during two world wars. The major discontinuity was in the growth of centralized welfare bureaucracies. The absence of concerted resistance to this extension of public intervention was a function of an exchange of rights for service. For all the rhetoric of domestic fortification, householders were in the last resort willing to trade with outsiders, where insurance officials and welfare visitors brought real material benefits. The state was permitted to extend its knowledge of personal circumstances. Only where, as in the case of the interwar means test, the intrusive detail of inquiry exceeded any available financial support, was there conflict. And this trajectory of change was not checked until the beginning of the final third of the century. The envisioned shift from analog to digital information processing created for the first time the possibility of large-scale record linkage. Although heroic levels of accuracy and efficiency were achieved by the paper-based national insurance system, it was impossible to connect its data to other files. The subjects maintained the integrity of their identity. The bureaucracies only manipulated discrete fragments. Now the prospect was created of creating an integrated dossier. You can see the quote there from a book in 1970. In practice, the introduction over the succeeding decades of large-scale data linkage systems has been fraught with difficulty, up to and including the current Universal Credit Program. But at the same time, since abortion, homosexuality, and divorce legislation in the late 1960s, the government has stayed out of the bedroom, and despite continuing public controversies, has yet to revisit any of its key reforms. I think the outcome has been growing uncertainty about the legitimate scope of governmental inquiry into private lives. The eruption of a continuing series of sex abuse scandals, particularly of children, has raised serious questions about whether the long-term withdrawal of official policing of intimate behaviour needs in some way to be reversed, particularly but not only with regard to the consumption of digital pornography. In terms of the surveillance of personal communication, the state is unwilling to abandon its centuries-old instinct to leave the boundaries of its powers as vaguely defined as possible, whilst at the same time unable to resist the siren call of bulk data collection. In the liberal polity, while there is debate, there is hope. But as it struggles to cope with the implications of the communications revolution, the British state appears not to know how to talk about privacy, not to know where to allocate responsibility for privacy, and as it addresses the threats and opportunities of digital surveillance, it no longer knows what it does not need to know. Thank you very much.
So everybody, our second speaker for today is Karlin Lillington, and in addition to holding a PhD from Trinity College Dublin concerning Seamus Heaney, no less, you should know that long before Edward Snowden, Karlin Lillington was talking about digital surveillance in EU policymaking in the late 1990s up until now, and today she will be talking to us on the topic of privacy and page one, the challenge of engaging readers and editors.
Okay, and I assume I just hit the slideshow. I'm the only technology journalist in the world who can't even work a basic slideshow. So if I go flying through the slides, just accidentally just shout. I thought I would start with a little bit of context and then give some personal experience of covering data retention in Ireland, where it of course, became pivotal to the overthrow of by the ECJ of the EU Data Retention Directive, and then end with a few ironies, maybe to go into the discussion. But digital privacy is the most difficult and perplexing subject I write about as a technology journalist. And whatever about explaining the cloud and algorithms and why a company like Twitter, with little revenue and no profits, can have a multi-billion dollar valuation, privacy abstractions, and I'm sorry, I keep moving back and forth between privacy and privacy, but privacy abstractions are aggravatingly challenging to explain to readers within the brisk word limits of a story or a column. Privacy, like security, is not straightforward, means different things to different people, and tends to be balanced against other values and rights, as we've been hearing all day today. Adding in digital to privacy makes it even more opaque. To give an example, the average person innately grasps that it's wrong for someone to follow them around all day, recording the places that they've visited and who they might have spoken to. Yet, though a mobile phone is viewed as fairly benign, the location metadata that it produces generates this type of information all day long, a record of our precise movements down to a few meters distance, which is correlatable against others in our vicinity. And likewise, the average person would be outraged if told to leave windows uncovered at all times, because law enforcement would like to occasionally glance in to make sure they aren't up to any shenanigans. And while you're doing that, why not hand over copies of the house keys just in case, you know, the people might get up to something in the future. And yet this is the digital trade-off of the, if you are doing nothing wrong, you have nothing to hide argument used to validate encryption backdoors and data retention. So writers like me try to use real-world metaphors to make the abstract more graspable, but readers still have a hard time comprehending that invisible electronic data of zeros and ones can be just as, and probably more revealing than what would be seen through the sitting room window. And I think this is in part due to the incessant push for greater access to our data from two deeply interested parties, the business world and governments. Adeptly, they both make the trade-off enticing and seemingly inconsequential, and therefore apparently trivial, when of course it's not. On the business side, corporates lure us into giving them access in exchange for what we might call cool stuff. The nifty jogging app, that effortless internet search, that free email service, that social media community. On the government side, we're encouraged to give up our data by warnings of vague consequences to our personal and national security if we don't, and we're pressured to believe that surrendering privacy is doing the right thing, especially in the face of terrorist threats, even though road traffic accidents in a single week in Europe or the US would take more lives than most terrorist attacks. Both approaches from business and government are insidious, but those coming from governments far more so, not only because they're relentless, manipulative, and scaremongering, but because their powers are vast and fewer restraints exist on what they can do, justified in the name of security. And as we know from the Snowden leaks, law enforcement agencies are lustful in the presence of rich data trawls that are available now thanks to our dependency, both voluntary and incidental, on digital devices and data storage. That's why I think this quotation from our advanced reading is a call to arms for journalists. It's certainly why I do what I do, because I believe at heart that the public does care deeply about privacy, even if confused by it or outwardly indifferent to its digital manifestations. But it's not just readers that matter. The editors to whom we file our copy also need to see data privacy is a subject demanding public understanding and informed scrutiny, as pressing as the news of a war or an election or a sports victory. But a time-harassed editor is usually far more sympathetic to the piece about a banking scandal or a politician's embarrassing affair than data retention, encryption backdoors, or surveillance. The few that do get it can face a hard battle to push stories up to needed visibility, much less to page one. And very few senior editors, in my experience, view privacy-related stories as page one material unless they're as blatantly dramatic and full of global embarrassment as the Snowden documents. But sometimes journalists who write about such things are lucky in the final outcome. Against the odds and despite niche readerships and distracted editors, change happens. And that occurred for me reporting on data retention, a sweeping and particularly odious form of public surveillance. That experience, I think, illustrates well how arbitrary and devious the claims of the state are in defending and instituting a data retention regime, and therefore why such plans must be constantly interrogated by the media and citizens and ultimately our courts. I think it also shows how challenging it is to write for the public on a topic not as outwardly dramatic as NSA and GCHQ spying programs with snappy code names and to convince editors of its importance. The end result of working around the Irish data retention issue, which was an overturned EU directive, hardly seemed possible back in 2001 when my involvement began with the story, meaning this story, revealing that UK mobile operators had been retaining phone location and it turned out other metadata for several years. This placed them outside the EU data protection directive, which mandated that data be gathered for a specific use and then destroyed, ideally within 6 months. I thought the revelations here were a useful way of exploring data retention and protection at a time when I thought few readers were probably aware of the darker privacy implications of digital communications formats. But I wanted an Irish angle on the story. I didn't just want to sort of report what was happening over in the UK. So I rang the two main mobile operators in Ireland, at that time called Aircel and ESAT Digiphone, to ask about their metadata policies, because I was sure that they were much smarter than the UK operators in that they'd tell me that they dutifully destroyed such data after 6 months. But instead, they cheerfully told me that they too stored data, including location data, for around 6 years, primarily in case they needed it to comply with the statute of limitations for disputed bills. And Aircel told me that although they atomized the data, as in they disconnected the names from the content, that on request from the Gardaí, they would put it back together for the Gardaí, the Irish police, themselves, which was something forbidden under data protection legislation. So I rang the Data Protection Commissioner's office, where the assistant commissioner was quite taken aback at this news, and the Irish Council for Civil Liberties I also called, and they were equally perturbed, and their co-chairman Malachy Murphy at the time said to me, it's effectively like having a tagging device on a person. So I wrote a piece on that ran on November 7th, 2001, with perhaps the most boring headline ever written, even by Irish Times standards, retention of mobile phone or mobile call records queried. And I mean, compare that to the Guardian headline here, which was full of Liberty's fear over mobile phone details. That was my dull story. And editors, of course, and this I'll come back to this point, is something to keep in mind, is editors are the gatekeepers who bequeath value to a story by placement and the headline. Well, my news editors cut the story by about a third, and they buried it on page 15. So here it was. But the story launched, I knew the story was important, and it launched a standoff between the then Data Protection Commissioner, Joe Mead, the government, and the telecoms companies. The Gardaí wanted to retain access for years, not months, for data. And the Department of Justice wasn't about to rush in legislation that would limit that access. And the telecoms companies were in no hurry to destroy potentially useful data, just like companies now who all feel that someday, somehow, they're going to monetize this data, so we don't want to throw anything away. Months passed, and little changed, except that the data retention debate had, in the wake of 9/11, predictably returned with greater force at EU level. But in Ireland, Mead began to ramp up pressure, threatening to halt the ability of mobile phone operators to bill their customers and the Gardaí to have access to any information at all, unless the state introduced properly considered retention legislation. Primary legislation was needed to comply with constitutional requirements in Ireland that legislation that would touch every citizen of the state could only be enacted after open parliamentary debate. So almost a year after I wrote that first piece, extraordinary that a year passed on something like this with nothing happening, I learned that a group of privacy advocates in Finland had got hold of a secret Council of Justice Ministers survey in which justice departments in every EU state were asked about the status of data retention in their country. And it revealed that Ireland, under then Minister for Justice Michael McDougall, who had become a sparring partner of mine for years on this issue, was planning to introduce data retention legislation with a storage period of at least 3 years, and wished to expand the types of data that they could collect and retain. Yet to a question on this form asking if the work of law enforcement in your country had been affected by not having data retention, the department replied with a single word answer, no. The government also noted that it had not consulted with the telecoms industry about proposed data retention legislation because the industry, they said, was already cooperative in releasing data that they needed for investigation, so they saw no problem, even though this was outside having any laws at all. One answer, though, confused me. Asked if data were currently being retained, the response was yes, under an order made by Minister for Public Enterprise Mary O'Rourke. And this made no sense to me at all. What order? And no one else I knew could understand what this response meant. But around the same time, so that was going on one side, a contact approached me and said, would I be interested in a Justice Department draft data retention bill? And would I ever be interested? And it outlined 4 years of data retention and proposed including internet metadata as well, which is a big step on from just call data. So I published a piece exposing the draft, and this made page one, or what we call in the Irish Times BP1, bottom of page one. So that's the most flexible slot on page one. So if something, you know, amusing comes up, it might go there and my piece might be consigned somewhere else. But there it is, there's the box, that's where I appeared. So it was one of my, business journalists covering technology don't often get page one stories, so this is quite exciting for me. But McDougall, in the wake of this, McDougall again promised to seek public and industry input on any proposed legislation, which resulted in an invite-only discussion forum in February 2003. But it wasn't very public or comprehensive. Originally, the Data Protection Commissioner wasn't invited at all, and he only found out about the forum because I called him up to ask him what he was going to say at the thing. But it turned out his contribution was the most revealing, because in his submission, Mead revealed that Minister O'Rourke had indeed made a secret cabinet order for the retention of call data for 3 years to guarantee ongoing data collection and Garda access in this legal vacuum that existed. Mead seized his opportunity to tell the audience this after McDougall very opaquely referred to it in his introduction to the forum. And that meant, of course, as Mead, an ex-civil servant, realized right away, that once it had been mentioned publicly, cabinet privileged information was now in the public domain and he could elaborate on it. And very few there realized the significance of the revelation, but of course it clicked right away. This was the leaked finished document. You know, it finally made sense. So I wrote a story on this debacle, which was far more significant in implication, obviously, than just a draft bill that ran on page one in 2002. And the news desk took it, but disappointingly, they ran it on page four. And yet again, in truncated form, they whacked off bits of it. So there I am, below the leading story about the Green Party losing a case over wanting their Ardesh, their annual conference, covered live. But of course, this was less important, even though it's a secret state surveillance, basically. And the details in this story would eventually form a key part of the argument against data retention when it went to the ECJ. And the disclosure itself became a new pressure point on the government, and an increasingly terse exchange between Mead and the Department of Justice that I obtained through Freedom of Information Act showed that Mead questioned the constitutional validity of bringing in what was in effect national surveillance, a point the ECJ would explicitly agree with and call data retention effectively surveillance on an entire population. But that Mead was questioning the constitutional validity of having brought that in through a secret cabinet order. Mead 5 times threatened the government with a high court action, which is extremely rare to happen, for ongoing delay in bringing in legislation, and for using what he termed an invalid ministerial direction to unconstitutionally store citizens' call data. The FOI document showed that he had taken legal advice indicating the direction was in breach of the Constitution and lacked the character of law. FOIs also showed that the Department of Justice had time and time again promised a bill, yet nothing happened for a further 2 years. Meanwhile, other officials were becoming concerned, and the Department of Communications in particular began to worry that data retention would prove a deterrent to inward investment from the increasing number of technology companies that were coming into Ireland. And in one FOI letter, the Department of Communications pointed out to the Department of Justice, the imposition of a 3-year data retention period for the purposes of criminal investigation, etc., is an entirely new concept and should not be portrayed as a mere amendment to existing procedures. It also added it found no particular justification for this period or any statistical information that would indicate this to be the optimum period based on previous experience of Gardaí investigations. The Gardaí, meanwhile, were asking for 7 years retention. Just pick a random figure out of the air. That seems to be what they did. And by this point, I'd written so many pieces on the data retention issue that every time I walked into the office, one of my editors would raise his head above his computer monitor and drawl, "So how's Ms. Data Retention today?" Well, Ms. Data Retention was not happy at all when in early 2005, now this is 4 years after my initial story, Ireland suddenly got one of the most aggressive data retention laws in the world because unexpectedly Minister McDougall introduced a very small amendment to the Criminal Justice Terrorist Offences Bill in its final stages of discussion before a nearly empty parliamentary chamber. And the amendment, which permitted 3 years retention of call metadata, came in with such stealth that even the members of parliament, business leaders, and privacy advocates who had been following the issue closely were caught unawares. I only found out because a TD, the Irish version of MP, rang me in California where I was visiting family. It was a prominent Sinn Féin TD as well, which is, of course, one of the frustrations over this issue. The only parties that ever seemed to be interested were parties like Sinn Féin, and everyone would say, well, of course, that would be who was interested. But I actually didn't believe him at first because I thought he must have misunderstood the situation, because the Department of Justice by this point was on the record so many times promising a full parliamentary and public debate in the introduction of a standalone bill. But when I started ringing people for comment, no one believed me. And I found myself in the bizarre position of having to persuade them that we now had data retention. And yet again, the story, which I found shocking in a democracy, was consigned to the business section. But this incident, too, would form a critical part of the case presented to the ECJ. So on and on it went. Irish data retention legislation was updated in 2010 to include the EU 2006 Data Retention Directive, which was itself strongly influenced by the Irish laws. But the EU legislation brought in a shorter mandated retention time of 2 years, so at least our situation improved and that the retention period was cut back. And around that time, a really small group of privacy advocates and legal experts who'd recently formed an advocacy group called Digital Rights Ireland served notice on the government and Garda, ordering them to cease the collection, storage, and accessing of mobile and fixed line phone data. If they did not, the group said it determined or it intended to begin high court proceedings to challenge the constitutional validity of Ireland's data retention laws. And need I say, nothing happened. Data continued to be collected. And the DRA case was quietly filed. Eventually, the High Court referred it to the European Court of Justice, asking for clarification on the validity of the EU directive before giving an opinion on the Irish law. And to my great pride, the written DRI filing to the ECJ footnoted and was largely based on facts revealed through my years of reporting, which begs the question, why did some of these stories make page one and others not? And there's a whole huge body of stories, like dozens and dozens and dozens of stories I was writing at this time. And to be honest, I still have no idea why some were considered page one candidates and others could sink to the furthest reaches of the news section or run somewhat disappointingly in the business as business stories. And over the years, I'd started writing, instead of doing these pieces as news stories, I just gave up on writing them as news stories, and I'd started writing them in my weekly opinion column, because at least there I could take a position and formulate an argument on a topic I felt needed advocacy, not neutral news reporting, if even the most alarming stories were not given the urgency bestowed by page one prominence. And I will say that my immediate editors in the business section better understood these issues, encouraged me and regularly fought to get these pieces into news or to the front page, sometimes with success. And as a journalist, that modest support was terribly important and kept me working away at a topic I felt the public urgently needed to know about and understand. Over time, I learned that even the editors and media kingpins you think might be a sure bet for promoting investigative writing on data privacy can be lukewarm in support, though. At the time I wrote most of these pieces, the Irish Times editor-in-chief was Geraldine Kennedy, one of the paper's renowned political correspondents, and here she is on the right with the infamous Taoiseach Charlie Haughey on the left. Now, she certainly was in a position to be more privacy and surveillance focused than most, because in 1981, the then Taoiseach Charles Haughey here, knowingly permitted his justice minister to tap Kennedy's personal phone calls, as well as those of prominent journalists Bruce Arnold and Vincent Brown, trying to determine who was leaking stories to them about the government. And the tapping incident came out in the 1980s, and you'll laugh at this picture, I think. This is a very young Pat Kenny, who's now left RTE, but talking about the story. But I just love that phone and the reel-to-reel tape drive there too. The tapping incident came out in the 1980s, but when Haughey's direct involvement was revealed in the early 90s, it actually forced his resignation. And new surveillance legislation was passed as a result in 1993, which is the basis is part of the basis of our current data retention as well, which bars ministers from signing surveillance orders. Yet Geraldine was not particularly Madam was not particularly predisposed to highlighting stories on data privacy, I think because she really didn't get the digital parallel of her own analog surveillance experience. And likewise, when I first wrote about the plan to bring in data retention, that story that ran on page one, I got a call from Vincent Brown's radio program asking me to appear on this very influential evening show. And I briefed his researcher, and I was sure that Brown, because of this background, would be scandalized by the government's secret motives with data retention. But instead, Brown dismissively grilled me. If people aren't doing anything wrong, why should they care if the Gardaí get data about their phone calls? Sure, they can listen to mine all they want. I've got nothing exciting there, is what he said. And I was dumbfounded at this, and I wondered if any source would ever risk going to him with a story again. But ultimately, this is what happened. 13 years after that first story, the ECJ decided that particular perspective, if you've done nothing wrong, you've got nothing to hide, you shouldn't mind having these large data archives held for years, just in case people do wrong. The ECJ decided this perspective was very much in the wrong. And on April 8th, in a scathing opinion on the DRI case, the ECJ dramatically threw out the EU data retention directive, one of a handful of times this has ever happened in EU history, on the grounds that although some data need to be collected for law enforcement reasons, the directive fundamentally interfered with private life and was greatly disproportionate in achieving its intended goals. In short, in sentence after sentence of the ruling, the judges hammered home all the arguments that I and others had made for so long. This was an extraordinary moment for advocates of data privacy and proportionality, and it also is very emotional for me to have a career-long conviction that data retention was wrong, validated by the most powerful court in Europe. For over a decade, I'd really felt the loneliness of the long-distance writer on this issue, never a popular topic, and this was like suddenly bursting through the tape at the end of a marathon in my Ms. Data Retention sash with crowds cheering. It also reminded me that in writing about such issues, journalists create a public record that can be important in its own right, so that even if readers do not necessarily embrace the topic at the time, the powerful arm of the justice system ultimately may. And I think the topic would attract more attention now anyway, post-Snowden, post-several major ECJ data privacy decisions. There's like Schrems, for example, following on the DRI case and the Google Right to be Forgotten case. There's a far greater public interest in data privacy. In the Irish Times itself, I'm pleased to say, just currently set up a dedicated online section for data privacy reporting. And I really feel we are very much on top of that area, unlike a lot of papers internationally. Nationally, we have about five of us, amazingly, across law and European-based journalists, US and myself, that all have a particular interest in this area. And but back to story positioning. Given this glorious result, where did my story on this historic court decision end up? Well, on page one, kind of. There I am in the very bottom. See the arrow down there? It's just a little blurb below the dental care story in Business and Property, where it says, data ruling, a directive requiring telecom operators to retain data for 2 years has been deemed invalid. So there I am, way back in the business section again. So all of my pride was completely punctured by this. And on here on page one, you can see we're all obsessed with the visit of Queen Elizabeth to Ireland. And then this a story below it, you know, apparently a story about the colleges were being asked to become more commercial was more important than the fact that a small Irish-based rights organization and a lot of Irish Times coverage had helped to contribute to the fall of a really odious directive. But there you go. And I'd like to just conclude with a little ironic addendum here, because earlier this year, a fellow Irish Times journalist revealed that GSOC, the Garda Síochána, our police ombudsman commission, had gained access to journalist call records as part of an investigation into how stories were being leaked from the Gardaí to journalists. And the case at stake involved the death of a celebrity model due to drug use several years earlier, which is unfortunate, but hardly fitted the only for the most serious crime and terrorism parameters the government insisted would carefully determine when call records were accessed under data retention legislation. The GSOC story made headlines and top news bulletins for days as journalists and unions found that they were shocked by such gross interference with their work. Forgotten was that what this implied for the general public, that a person's call records could be demanded in the most unlikely and questionable scenarios, not just journalists. And also ignored by journalists writing on this case was the scandal that despite the ECJ ruling, the old Irish data retention law is still in place. And surprise, apparently these tight restrictions on who can access data that's are supposedly in that and are explicitly in that legislation, supposed to be limited to our revenue department, the police, and the armed forces, includes a very long roster of smaller agencies that have statutory rights in the context of their own investigations. So a point that surely reaffirms the ECJ's decision to throw out the EU directive as allowing disproportionate, poorly supervised levels of access and surveillance. But no one writing about GSOC made that connection or wondered why 2 years on we were still basing access on a law based on a voided directive, which all goes to show that maybe to get privacy stories into the headlines, you just make the story all about journalists, offend their sensibilities, and they will write and write and write. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karlin. And just so we're all clear, we have the same kind of laws here in the UK under DRIPA until the sunset clause at the end of the year. And then the IP bill may reinstate those metadata or communication data retention laws again. So for our final speaker of this panel, Simon Rice, he is the group manager or head of technology at the Information Commissioner's Office, the UK's Data Protection Authority. He is therefore heavily involved in the area of data protection compliance, an element that we haven't yet addressed today, but a very important one. Implementation and compliance is obviously key. Simon also holds a PhD from the University of Manchester in the field of data mining, and he will be discussing preserving privacy in publicly available data.
Thank you very much. I think I've got technology in my job title, so thankfully everything's coming to work for me. Thank you very much for the introduction. As you know, the ICO, the independent regulator, which upholds information rights of UK individuals. So we've now got five pieces of legislation that we're regulating at the moment. So obviously the Data Protection Act itself and the Privacy and Electronic Communications Regulations, which are obviously relevant to today's discussion. Also the Freedom of Information Act, the environmental information regulations, and the latest one that we've added, the RPSI, which is all about getting access and reuse of public sector information. Now, my role at the ICO is to support the rest of the office with their technological problems, make sure that they have a good understanding of the cases that they're dealing with. Unfortunately, I haven't got a book to offer that I've authored, but I have also authored a number of bits of guidance that the ICO has published, available on the website, and a number of blogs, and topics included the most recent one on encryption and Wi-Fi location tracking, the later one I'll talk a little bit about just now. Also looking at privacy implications in development of mobile apps, bring your own devices, cloud security, IT security, and also generally processing information online and online services. So eventually myself and the team, we offer assistance, about 50% of our work with the enforcement teams in the ICO, supporting their role in the enforcement cases. For example, recent civil monetary penalties against the money shop of £180,000 for a lack of security measures. That Stayshore, another £175,000 against a website attack. They failed to prevent the attack on their breach on their website. And Worldview, another online payment service website. Also helped the policy advice coming out of the ICO. I mentioned the guidance, but also any other advice there for the ICO, but also on the EU level. So I sit on the technology subgroup of the Article 29 Working Party, the advisory group to the European Commission. So I was going to consider the publicly available data, what I've called publicly available data. And by that, I mean that's sort of easily accessible by any of the devices or services that we use, perhaps your mobile phone or social networking. So I thought about the question as well of today's event, why privacy? So I thought I'd start off with looking at it from perhaps the organization's perspective. Why should they bother about privacy? And quite simply, it makes for good business sense. So there are many businesses relying on the collection and processing of personal data, and doing so properly will support those business models in the long term. Back on the 25th of January 2016, which I'm sure is a date that all fits in your memory as EU Data Protection Day, so you can put it in your dates in your diaries for next year, the ICO, we commissioned YouGov to do a quick poll on our behalf. And this poll reported that 20% of individuals would be certain to stop using a service if it suffered a data breach. And another 57% would consider doing so. Oh, I've just released the information there. Only 8% of individuals said it would make no difference to their use of a service if their personal data was breached in an attack. So therefore, suffering a data breach means that an organization can lose up to 80% of its customers. So I think maybe privacy isn't dead, as perhaps we've already heard today. But even if a data breach hasn't occurred, individuals are ready to complain to the ICO as the regulator of the Data Protection Act. So last year, the ICO received 14,268 data protection concerns and over 180,000 complaints relating to PECA, which includes submissions to our online tools. So it's going to be a lot higher relating to calls or spam calls and texts. So if that's not good enough, I can give you another reason to respect data protection and privacy, and it's because it's the law. And can lead an organisation with a civil monetary penalty of up to £500,000. So I'm sure these are all the eight principles of the Data Protection Act that you're all very well aware of. But what it does, it provides the framework of control around the use of personal data by a data controller and further use by any other third parties to which that data might be disclosed. And really making sure that it provides the tools for the user to remain in control of their privacy and of their personal data. And the result of some of those 14,000 complaints that we received in the 14-15 financial year resulted in the ICO taking 26 undertakings, 3 enforcement notices issued, 12 prosecutions, and 11 civil monetary penalties. So the majority of civil monetary penalties were issued by the ICO for a breach of Principle 7, or around the security of the personal data that's being processed. Now, on the one side, security can be a bit simpler to specify that minimum standard. So if we say, well, you must use encryption in certain circumstances or follow a minimum standard if you're processing data, setting a policy for updating your software or putting a minimum policy around requirements around passwords. But privacy is more difficult to regulate. Firstly, the word privacy doesn't appear in the Data Protection Act or in many of the 400, I think it is, pages of the General Data Protection Regulation, which was finally adopted by the Parliament just last week. But of course, this legislation respects the fundamental rights in the European Charter of Human Rights, including that respect for private and family life, home and also in communications. And we've heard this morning, privacy means different things to different people. And we've already heard this. You know, people have different expectations and defaults. So I think this is where the Data Protection Act comes in and defines that minimum standard of transparency, choice, user control, you know, security and access rights, you know, for users to remain in control of the processing of their personal data. Now, for me, I think the key aspects of personal data, processing personal data in compliance with the DPA, are transparency and security. Now, of course, these aren't the only requirements, but I think, you know, looking at transparency, it's, we'll tell people about what you're doing in a way so that they've got a clear and comprehensive understanding of what you're going to do with their data, and then go ahead and do it securely. But of course, so we'll come back to these in a minute. So just look at some new technologies and some of the different data protection issues that are there. Think about communication technologies or use of the internet and smartphones. Their usage can generate a vast amount of metadata. Some of this is obviously processed by the mobile phone companies for the provision of their network services, but others are generated by the operating systems, the apps and the software that we've used. We've got IP addresses, MAC addresses, you know, location information coming from GPS or movement data from our accelerometer and our compass, HTTP headers, advertising identifiers, session identifiers, or any other data relating to tracking or advertising profiles and usage patterns. And therefore, a vast amount of data, which can then relate to the individual that's using those devices to generate that information. And therefore, it could be personal data. But the individual can be completely unaware of its existence, and let alone who that data or where that data is being transferred to. Certainly, if the individual is unaware, we're not hitting that transparency requirement. So looking at location tracking, the example there in the top right there. Certainly when we're looking at things like facial recognition or tracking and advertising, there's that classic reference to the film Minority Report, where an iris scan of recognition can deliver personalized adverts to the individual. And in a way, your face is a good example of that sort of publicly available data. So just because that your face is publicly available, does that mean that organizations or the state can use that data for their own purpose? Well, clearly not. And that's one of the reasons we have notices about CCTV, letting you know that it's actually operating you and telling you who the controller is there. And all that classic data protection myth that emerges in the media every December that says you cannot film your child's nativity play. Data protection won't stop that taking place. But what I find is interesting, certainly when we're looking at these newer technologies, that on one hand, you don't need to bother with facial recognition when you've got, say, 10 or more unique digital identifiers being carried around with you, publicly broadcast in the clear. So Christina was looking at the contents of wallets this morning. Whilst I was on the train last night, coming down, reading over my notes, I counted 7 devices in my bag that were emitting identifiers and could have been tracked for their location. So I had 2 tablets with sort of Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GSM and GPS sensors there, 2 smartphones, a watch, keyboard, and wireless headphones. So that means I'm emitting up to 11 unique MAC addresses at various intervals, which could be passively collected, stored, and to recognize if I return to a particular location. So just after this morning, I started thinking about what's in my wallet as well. And I think something like 4 contactless payment cards. I've got my bag, my work bags. I've actually got 2 Oyster cards, one for work journeys, one for personal journeys. I've also got 2 contactless cards for the Brussels Metro, because I'm going there this afternoon. I've also got my contactless ID badge and also my passport, which I then remind myself of that's got a wireless sort of sensor in there. So there's a huge amount of information that you could potentially gather off me. Some of them you have to be a little bit closer to me to actually get those identifiers than others. But you can also infer things about me, about the devices that I'm carrying. If I've got all that technology, perhaps I'm an early adopter, and you could then target or advertise in a different way. But they're all a different mix of manufacturers, which you could gather from the different MAC addresses. You could also infer that my watch is not an iWatch or an Apple Watch, so maybe you want to sell me one. Or maybe you don't want to because I've got the really cheap one, so I'm not going to spend enough money. You can infer whatever you want. Or also, because I've got all of these devices, maybe I'm a target for mugging. Perhaps, but maybe not, because I've got loads of contactless payment cards, so I don't have any cash on me, so it's not worth it. But of course, so if these are being collected by an organisation, is there a valid legal basis for that collection of those identifiers, retaining them for some indeterminate length of time, perhaps hoping you recognise me when I return in order to make that decision? Certainly a MAC address, when it's linked either back to a device with an individual or with a location, date and time, can easily be considered as personal data. So therefore we need that legal basis for the processing. Thinking about transparency. You can easily notify me about that, the processing that's going on, with the same stickers that you might be using to advertise the fact that there's a Wi-Fi network there. Well, you want to entice me into the coffee shop because there's free Wi-Fi, well, let me know that there's a location analysis going on at the same time. Also, do we need to keep it in an identifiable form? Now we can hash the MAC address or generate aggregate statistics and delete the original data, again, removing some of those residual privacy issues. And then maybe some of you starting to think, well, what's the problem? Does it matter that we know that Simon comes to the same coffee shop every day? You know, we've already heard a lot about the state surveillance through telecommunications data and data retention there. But obviously, don't forget that law enforcement can request all of this data from a private organisation and perhaps also be considered within the perspective of this debate. Also looking at social media data. We had a case more recently looking at the Samaritan's Radar app, which was an app that allowed you to receive a notification if one of the people that you follow on Twitter posts something that, the Samaritans deemed as concerning. Now, obviously, it's not your personal data that they're modifying, but you've enrolled your friends into this system. And certainly no indication this was going on to the individual whose Twitter feed was being monitored. But again, of course, on one argument, one said, well, it's all public. It's all publicly available data, but perhaps not within the reasonable expectations of those individuals that were submitting those tweets. What I can say is after a conversation with the ICO, it's no longer operating. You can draw your own conclusions. In the same way, we have things like sort of social scoring based on Facebook profiles or social media data. Some areas use as a proxy for creditworthiness or debasing insurance risk. You know, on one question, think about it yourself. Is your Facebook social graph a better or worse indicator of your creditworthiness or insurance risk than perhaps your evidence of 10 years no claims discount or the fact that you've been a regular payment of your mortgage? Now, maybe you're a bit horrified by the fact that you could use this kind of data for those purposes. But if you're 18 and you don't have a mortgage and you don't have that history of credit, then it perhaps is a good thing that you can use a different method of applying for credit or insurance, so assuming it's good news for you. And then, of course, there's on the other side of things how the Facebook friends might be feeling about this as contributing towards your credit score. So think about transparency. Now, let's pretend I'm a chief executive of a startup which is developing this wonderful black box Internet of Things device. I know, doesn't it look great? It's wonderful minimalist design, a simple black box with no lights or screen. You just plug it in and it starts processing your personal data to deliver a rich, immersive experience in your daily life. Well, that's what it will say on the marketing. Now, would you read the privacy notice? You know, there was a small leaflet in the box which described what my new product does. But I bet you were so excited when you opened the box, you left this packaging, left this in the packaging, and it's now in the recycling. Now, it's not to say that the privacy notice isn't important. It's quite the opposite. You know, it provides an important reference of the data processing that you were undertaking or the organisation was undertaking. But it may not be the best place to be the sole repository of the information or the description of the processing that you're undertaking. And if someone hasn't read the information, how can they then be fully informed? Certainly if you're seeking consent for the legal basis for that processing, it needs to be fully informed, freely given and specific. If all that information is now in the recycling, that's a very difficult match to make. But there's also other things you can do. You know, use videos, animation, information in social media, icons and logos, you know, to make sure that users are fully informed rather than just relying on the piece of paper now in the recycling. And also privacy-friendly defaults to ensure that the processing of personal data doesn't take place until the users are informed. But just because information is placed in the privacy policy doesn't mean it's been read or understood or even seen. Important information can't be hidden within a large blocks of inaccessible legalese. But you can also use parts of the product itself to inform and gain consent if necessary. Now, this is a bus stop that was on Oxford Road that uses facial recognition. But the advert itself informs that a camera is operating and actually engages with the user. So as the user comes closer, the text actually changed. And if the user walks away, well, that's a good indicator of the lack of consent and the processing should cease. So there was also information on the outside of the bus stop. So you were informed before you went in. But also think about there's other opportunities. I said, my black box doesn't have a screen. But it does have a companion smartphone app, and there is a website for users to register. So that gives ample opportunity to inform and give users choice regarding data processing. Which brings us back to security. Certainly there's a rush to market at the moment for a number of organizations trying to get that product there as quick as they can. with sufficient regard to both privacy, data protection and security. Certainly in my perspective, you know, there's no excuse for a lack of encryption, or certainly of a data transfer, or the use of default or hard-coded passwords. Products should be capable to keep up to date and supported where necessary by that organisation to protect those users in the future. Also got those considerations of the cloud storage of data being stored outside of that device somewhere. It needs to be kept secure. Certainly organisations such as TalkTalk, Ashley Madison and a certain law firm in Panama will all highlight the need to increase and devote significant resources to online security and storage of data. We'll certainly want to avoid headlines such as this, where individuals are installing many, many more devices in their home, whereby the default installation requires, essentially the default installation is insecure and requires such a specific configuration by the user to configure it. What this actually was is a website, a search engine that could go through and find these webcams that are completely open and unsecured or using default passwords. And that was a picture of a baby sleeping somewhere in Canada that was publicly available on the internet. And the parents probably just didn't know, which is really, really not a good situation to be in. So how do we achieve that transparency and security? How does a data controller achieve that gold standard? And for me, the first start is with that PIA, or Privacy Impact Assessment. Really to sit back, stop, look and listen. Before a project gets underway, think about the data that's being processed. Is it necessary? Or can an alternative be used? And can you achieve that same level of processing in a different way? Look at where the data is flowing and look at those third-party libraries that might be included within a product. And once we've got that privacy impact assessment in place, the developers can look at the risks and issues that are within those data flows, put in steps to mitigate them. You know, this can mean using a different type of data, developing information, adding an icon or a light where necessary, adding in those user controls that the Data Protection Act requires to bring those users back in control of their personal data. But some people will say that the privacy impact assessment won't fit with their business models, especially in startup sort of scenarios where we're doing agile software development. But a PIA doesn't mean you need to change your business. You know, it really just means pause occasionally, sit down and think. And both you would do the same for security, privacy, or other types of legal obligations. And then include these sort of assessments, you know, regular assessment in the progress of that product or service. And it's certainly easier to try and consider these at the very beginning of any project, both privacy, security, rather than trying to bolt it on at the outset at a later date. But I think individuals, they also have a role to play. Some organizations do go to great lengths to develop and publish their privacy notices and privacy information in a simple and easy to understand manner. But individuals themselves, we need to engage, understand how our data is also being processed in order to be in a position to assess whether we are happy to transact with that organization, with that particular company in that manner. And certainly, to finish off, there is no such thing as our free lunch. So when an organization is offering a service, you know, for free or low cost, individuals do need to consider where that value is coming from. And if it is from their data, if it is from the consumer, just to be sure that we're happy with our end of the bargain before continuing. And if you're not happy, then please be one of those 20% of those individuals who would definitely move services and find somewhere else to leave your personal data. Thank you very much.
Well, everybody is getting their questions ready. Actually, I see someone with a question, but because I'm chair, I'm going to totally exploit that position of power. And to follow on the theme of wallets and purses today, I received this wallet at Christmas from an aunt. And she said, I saw this and I thought of you. And I thought, I like red. It is a very nice wallet. But she said, no, this is to protect your wireless ATM cards. Marks and Spencer's have designed this so that cards will not be hackable through. And I have tested it at a number of locations. And just to let everybody know, I can vouch for Marks and Spencer's wallet tap security proof devices. So questions, please. I think Ruben's over here and then next David. Sorry, just a quick note. If you could please introduce yourself so that everybody knows your background and research focus before you ask your question. Thank you.
Reuben Binns, University of Oxford. Question for Karlin and maybe Simon if he feels able to comment, but I understand if he doesn't. Interesting kind of history of the Irish commissioner. Is it Data Protection Commissioner?
Yeah.
Right. So, and I wasn't really aware of it. And I'm wondering if you could comment on whether you think that the capacity and the competency to regulate has changed over the course of the various. So it was Joe Mead and now Billy Hawkes. And whether
Helen Dixon
and now, right, yes, okay, and now someone you, and whether you think that the that's changed over the years, and how you think it might change in future given the new regulation coming through.
Well, people may not realize there's also a new legal challenge in from Digital Rights Ireland, questioning the procedures used to appoint Ireland's DPA because right now it falls under, bizarrely, the Department of Justice. So the very department you think you would want to be most scrutinizing, you're under their arm. And it tends to have always been staffed. It's a single person staffed through tends to be civil servants or ex-civil servants. And if you get somebody who's midway in their career, they might not really want to be rattling too many cages if they're looking for promotion. So I think DRI are right on that. So I guess to the first part of that, do I think the regulation, you know, the way things have been regulated have changed or improved? I think it has gradually grown stronger in different ways, perhaps. As the remit has broadened, but part of the challenge has been even getting enough power to do very much. This has always been a problem in the new general the GDPR. I always forget the order of the number. General Data Protection Regulation will address some of that, but personally, I feel the current Data Protection Commissioner is probably is definitely the least accessible one we've had. Partly, I would say, because of the DRI challenge right now, but she's refusing to talk to journalists. Full stop. It's the first Data Protection Commissioner who I've never even met, had no contact with, nothing from the office, and which I think is kind of bizarre because I'm probably the only journalist that's really from the start, you know, given them a lot of coverage and in what they would probably view as a positive way. And the fact that she doesn't give out her number to anybody, nobody can reach her. So I'd like to see the way in which that appointment is made changed.
Thanks.
Would you like to follow up?
Just very quickly, just a question on the competencies increasing over time. Yes, I'm now employed at the ICO and I wasn't 6 years ago. And also I started as a principal policy advisor and now I'm a group manager because now I have a team underneath me of technical specialists. So certainly the ICO things are increasing. I know at the Irish Commission they've recently employed someone of similar role to myself and he's got a team as well now. And our new commissioner coming in June, July has also got experience in the technological world as well. So always a good thing. But also a thing I have in the back of my mind is looking at our entire caseload, only a small proportion of it does involve online processing. So there is, still a lot of paper breaches and issues that do result.
Okay, so as of July, we'll have two Helens as DPAs, Helen Dixon and Helen Denham. I hope the press don't confuse them. David, your next question, please.
Do you want to just talk?
I'll just get a mic to you quickly. Thank you.
David Erlis from the law faculty here, and I suppose I study data protection almost full time for my sins. Thanks, Simon, for a really interesting and revealing talk. I suppose I had sort of two thoughts or questions related to it. I was reminded by two kind things from the ICO recently. I mean, one was from Richard Thomas way back a few years ago, I think possibly as former information commissioner, saying that the GDPR was likely to make liars and outlaws of us all. And I suppose it's just, you can go through the very broad brush sort of principles, but in fact it is 300 pages long. And any kind of mention of anybody in any context in principle triggers a vast labyrinth and thicket of provisions. And how is that sensible to regulate this area? And the second one was the app survey, which the Information Commissioners, along with the Global Privacy Enforcement Network, produced a few years ago in 2014. And it's admirable that they are. I mean, I think it's absolutely admirable that you are. But it found that 85% of the apps surveyed, and they only really looked at the big apps, 85% failed to clearly explain how they were collecting, using, and disclosing personal information, which is an absolute legal requirement, even under existing law. So, I mean, in a way, we carry on year after year talking about this, but if the actual reality is 85% of things which in fact are moving on like a tidal wave are breaking the law, what on earth are we going to do to bring legal clarity and a proper coherent regime to this area? Because to be honest, we haven't really heard very much in terms of enforcement and actual action since 2014. But if these figures are even vaguely right, there's a vast edifice of illegality to tackle.
That sounds like a question for me. Certainly, I mean, on those, any that were within the UK jurisdiction, we wrote to...
I only wrote to the very specific ones, but that's hardly the point, is in fact there's a systemic problem which is being
revealed. Yeah, and again, the point of the survey is to highlight that and on one hand, hope that app developers do take it on board. Now, hoping is not a very good manner of enforcement. But again, so we followed that up again with those that are specific to the UK that we have, you know, powers to enforce against. It was, yeah.
You know, whereas we're talking about tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, potentially subject to UK jurisdiction.
Yes, I mean, ultimately, our powers only extend to within the UK data controllers, which is
processing in the context of the UK or using equipment within the UK.
Yes, I mean, but that's the whole point of working within the GPEN group. We're working with international enforcement agencies so we can extend the reach, you know, and get that level of cooperation, which we're doing, for example, with Ashley Madison, which was a case, they're based in Canada and Toronto. Now, there's no point us trying to tackle them on our own, so we're working with the Canadian authorities on that so we can get a better resolution for the UK individuals.
So we've got about 5 minutes left, so if I could ask the remaining people to keep their questions as succinct as possible. Thank you.
Okay, Charles Arthur, I'm a journalist, used to work at The Independent, used to work at The Guardian. It's for Karlin, really, which is, don't you find that the whole problem with data protection stories is that they tend to be abstract, and it's very, very difficult to get news editors, all the people in newspapers interested in abstract stories because they say, well, we've got something about someone being murdered down the road, and that's much more interesting. I mean, even the thing you cited with the dentist thing coming above your blob about the ECJ decision is because people know what a dentist is. They know what their teeth are. But, you know, the whole question of what happens with data retention, data protection, so abstract. But if you can say someone tapped someone's phone, again, that's not abstract. That's something you can relate to.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That is a core issue. And it's, as I was trying to say, it's easier if it's the NSA and GCHQ and you have names like PRISM associated with it and people, you know, it's a little more concrete to people. But data retention, I think that's partly why it was such a lonely job to cover that story, even though I try to encourage other journalists within Ireland to look at, you know, please, I'd rather have all of us covering it, not just me covering it, and have something happen. And as it turned out, you know, it took the courts to make some change. But it's it's always the issue. And how do you bring it back? How do you find how do you get the time with an editor to explain what's going on? And how do you write the story in such a way that it's understandable quickly to an audience? And the other problem always with technology when you're writing for a general audience is that a good chunk of your story is going to be taken up just with going through some sort of a very brief explanation of something like encryption. Might take, you know, to do encryption in 150 words is a nightmare, but what if you've only got 500 words and that's more than a fourth of your story gone, you know? So it's those are the kind of battles, yeah, that we face all the time.
Okay, so we have two more questions up at the front here, just on the right and then on the left. Thank you. So just wait for the mic so everyone can hear you. Thank you.
Sorry, my name's Andrew Brown. I work on The Guardian. I wonder what you think the proper amount of data retention is. And the reason for this, for asking this question, is it seems to me there's a big principle distinction between the Snowden-type trawling of stuff in real time as it happens and the use for the police of data retention, because most police work does not come about from sort of looking for crimes and then trying to find criminals. You're working backwards. You've got a criminal, you're trying to find out what they're up to. That's actually in practice how police works. And for that, it seems to me that there is a legitimate case for data retention. The cops are going to want it. They're really going to want to know who these people's associates are. So how much do you think is fair? At what point is the cutoff?
You might have a perspective on this as well, David, but really quickly, I agree that 6 months seems to be sufficient, and there have been surveys done on this within states and on an EU-wide basis, that and the one within Ireland showed that, or that this came up before the ECJ, that almost no data used in criminal cases came from data held for longer than 6 months, and when you got up to like 2 years, there were only a tiny handful of cases. And within Ireland, the argument made by our own government and police forces for why they wanted really long periods of retention is because they secured convictions in the case of the journalist Veronica Guerin and the OMA bombings are two that were regularly cited. But actually, the evidence for both of those cases was retrieved within just a couple of days of the incidents happening, and all the call records were adequate within that. So actually, there's very little evidence that they need long period storage. That 6 months seems to cover it fairly well, and that there's other forms of evidence that can be used as well. But you might want to address that on the...
Well, no, but it raises a more general question of the extent to which the state can cope with the material which it now has potential access to. It's the needle and haystack argument, with which you'll be familiar. And a good number of the critics of current proposed legislation see themselves as trying to save the state from itself, that its capacity to collect material is going to obscure its capacity to understand this material, and that reducing the volume of archived material and research material that's available to them may actually enable them to solve the problems that they're being paid to solve.
Just quickly on that, on the one-year data retention proposed under the current IP bill, the Luxembourg court may soon have an answer on the legality of that in the David and Watson case next month. So final question, please, from Perry. Thank you.
Hi, Perry Keller, King's College London. I just wanted to follow up on the reference you made to the Samaritans, because I think it also ties into what David was saying about the comprehensibility of data protection law, because I know somebody very well who works in the Samaritans headquarters and say that they had advice before they went ahead. They're in the area of suicide prevention and counseling. It's a very sensitive area which involves them deeply in data protection issues. So they had advice, and the consequence has been, out of all that, and the way you dealt with it was probably left it to impress that they now were advised, but in fact, it's an organization which is just hypersensitive to data protection issues, but does not understand the law. They just know that they could have another media storm if they get it wrong, but they find the law incomprehensible.
I mean, yeah, no, it is certainly a very sensitive area around this. And I suppose it really does highlight that challenge of people have different perceptions of what is sensitive and what's going to be processed around their data and the implications of that. And I guess what sort of was there for us was looking at where the data has come from and what is the reasonable expectations of those individuals when they publish this information, whether it be on Twitter, Facebook, or any other social network. And then we had to look at that and go back to the legal aspects of it. Now, unfortunately, there's not quite a lot of clarity and guidance there. I mean, unfortunately, we can't have published guidance on absolutely every type of data processing operation that could ever be conceived. They are new emerging areas, certainly around the social networking data, which we're looking at. And again, thinking about these other areas of financial credit scoring and other different types of aspects like that, you know, it is a difficult area. And certainly this is why we remain open for organizations to come and speak to us around these types of activities so that we can, you know, all get them in, get them right really before they're published and put online.
Okay, everybody, I'd just like to thank the audience for some really excellent probing questions. I would also like to thank the speakers for addressing the rise of the secret state, for drawing us to the importance of the scrutiny of the press and the policy making of governments, particularly in the area of state surveillance, and also on the very complex major challenges facing our public officers in data protection compliance. Thank you very much, and now we'll break for coffee.